Gaia, we are good to go now. Please start the countdown.
Good morning, good afternoon, good evening. Happy World Hearing Day. My name is Gaia Gamhevage, and I work for the World Health Organization at our headquarters in Geneva, and it's my delight to be the moderator today. And what an hour we have to launch the first ever World Hearing Report. But before we get to that, I really want to acknowledge all of you who are here. I can see messages from people from Sweden to South Africa, from California to Japan. So it's a truly global event. And we have a great panel of world leaders, ministers, people who have experienced hearing loss or deafness, and people who just want to advocate for how we can protect our hearing. Today's a celebration. So to start off, I would really like to invite you all to experience the gift of music. And this is one of the nicest things that we do with our hearing. And it is brought to you by a very talented, hardworking, and passionate group of young men and women from South Africa. And they belong to the Nidrovo Youth Choir. We're going to talk to them in a little while, but I'm going to invite our technicians here to share with you a video that they have prepared to launch this important day. Thank you so much. As many of you are writing in the comments, what a beautiful way to start the day. And for some of you, it's very early in the morning, and for others, it's late at night. Before we go to the report, I really would like to spend a few minutes talking to Sandile Majola. Hi, Sandile.
Hello, 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 Gaia.
I know you're here with some members of your team, and yes. I know for you, you started this as a young 14-year-old. It'll be really interesting, I think, if you could share a little bit of a story about your choir. Why was it created, and what do you do?
Well, we are the Ndlovu Youth Choir, and we are from South Africa in a small province called Limpopo Mutse, And so the choir started as an afternoon program for children that are just roaming around the streets, for the youth to learn the skill and to learn music, to have confidence in ourselves. And it started in 2009 and became professional in 2018. And we were lucky enough to be in one of the biggest talent shows in the world, which is America's Got Talent, and that was 2019. And since then, we've been doing shows, we've been recording music and spreading love across the globe.
Thank you so much, Sandile. I was so excited by your video, I forgot to announce to everybody that actually we have interpretation in all of the UN languages and there's closed caption. So as we just continue the conversation, you know, we don't usually associate people as young as yourself with hearing loss. Yes. Why is this topic important to you?
Well, this topic is very important to me as, firstly, my friends and I are very excited to be part of this prestigious event. We are so lucky, we feel so lucky, and we are grateful for this opportunity. And would also like to thank the WHO for all its work on hearing. As musicians and singers, we often take this whole thing of hearing for granted, and we don't really pay attention and we don't really follow such issues. But we were fortunate enough that our choir master invited us, took us for hearing tests, and only then we realized how important it is to actually take care of your ears and to just don't listen to loud music and to just keep your ears dry. And you know, people don't really realize that. And once you go for hearing test, that's when you realize how actually important it is to take care of your ears. And it's very important that people know that once you lose your hearing, it's very hard to get it back. And it's never gonna be regained or restored. And hearing senses are the channel to your mind, which music flows through. And it creates magic, and we realize that, and we appreciate that. And it's our work that, as young stars, as the youth of South Africa, or as the youth of the world, we continue to teach people, to create an awareness, and make people aware of how important it is to really take care of your ears, and to do everything that you should do, like giving a rest to your ears, and not listening to loud music. Even if when you're listening to headphones and just play it softly, we find it as our job to be responsible for that as we have the platform.
Thank you so much, Sandile. So you started as a 14-year-old member of the choir. You're now the local choir manager, and you are absolutely looking at how to spread the message. So you found your voice, and now you're raising your voice for these great causes. I actually enjoyed early morning. I looked at many of your videos. So thank you so much. And we'll have you back to talk. So I'd like to move on and invite the Director General of the World Health Organization, Dr. Tedros, to officially launch the report and make some remarks and tell us how he feels, what is the importance of today. Dr. Tedros, over to you.
Thank you. Thank you so much, Gaia. That was really wonderful to start with the choir. Thank you. Thank you so much to Sandile and your friends. What a wonderful world, but I would also add, what a wonderful choir. So thank you so much. And look forward to working with you. And I would like to tell you that we're very, very proud of you, Sandile. So please tell your colleagues my respect and appreciation. So we're very proud. What a wonderful choir again. Thank you. Your Excellency, the Honorable Dr. Harsh Vardhan, Minister of Health and Family Welfare for India and Chairman of the WHO Executive Board, Namaste, Alana Nichols, Catherine Botten, and my colleagues here, Excellencies, distinguished guests, and friends. My sincere thanks to Sandile again, Sandile Majola, and than Dlovu Yoz Choir for your moving performance. Thank you all for joining us today for the launch of World Report on Hearing. This important document counteracts some of the widespread myth and misperceptions about hearing loss. One of them is that hearing loss is a problem of older people and is a sign of senility and decline. Your presence here is a wonderful step in showing the world that this is not true. Hearing loss affects people of all ages. The second myth is that hearing loss is inevitable. In fact, an estimated 60% of childhood hearing loss is due to preventable causes. When young people take responsibility for their hearing and become role models of safe listening, attitudes to hearing loss will start to change. On behalf of WHO, I thank you all for showing the world the importance of hearing loss prevention. Over 1.5 billion people currently experience some degree of hearing loss, and this number could grow to 2.5 billion by 2050. Nearly a third of them, close to 500,000 people, currently require hearing rehabilitation services. Hearing loss continues to be the world's third largest cause of disability, but we know how to prevent it. As Sandile told us so eloquently just now, we know how to prevent hearing loss that's caused by listening to loud music. We need to make listening safe for the 1.1 billion young people who are putting their hearing at risk simply by enjoying one of life's pleasures. We also know how to prevent and treat common ear infections, which continue to affect over 200 million children each year, leading to avoidable hearing loss. We also have effective solutions to address hearing loss. Millions of people are already benefiting from hearing aids, implants, therapy, sign language, and captioning. However, their use is still far too limited. Many people, especially in low-resource settings, cannot access these critical tools. Only about 17% of those in need are able to benefit from hearing care at present. This is the result of widespread under-prioritization of ear and hearing care. Ear and hearing care must be part of every country's journey towards universal health coverage. The human cost of this gap to people with hearing loss and their families is huge. At the same time, a heavy price is also levied on society at large. These cost-effective interventions are an investment in a healthier and more prosperous society. Without them, the global economy is estimated to lose close to $1 trillion each year. Inaction is no longer an option. The COVID-19 pandemic has taught us a hard lesson that health is not a luxury item. Rather, health is the foundation of social, economic, and political development and an investment in a safer, fairer, and more prosperous world for all people. Investing in ear and hearing care can, over 10 years, could benefit over 1.4 billion people and bring a return of nearly $16 for every dollar invested. The World Report on Hearing outlines clear actions that we must take to achieve the global target of a 20% relative increase in coverage of hearing care services by 2030. The annual investment to scale up ear and hearing care is estimated at $1.33 US per capita. Excellencies, dear colleagues and friends, I would like to again offer my thanks to His Excellency, the Honorable Dr. Harsh Vardhan, for his leadership in the field of ear and hearing care. India's work to ensure access to critical services by beginning at the community and primary care level is an example for others to emulate. Namaste, Your Excellency, and thank you so much for your leadership on this. The speakers today demonstrate that there are effective solutions to address the ear and hearing care needs of everyone. I want to assure member states and partners of WHO's commitment to ensuring access to ear and hearing care as an essential part of primary health care and universal health coverage. I wish you a happy World Hearing Day. I thank you.
Thank you very much, Dr. Tedros. Some of the figures you quoted are absolutely shocking. I wanted to also remind people that WHO has a free app, a mobile phone app on iOS and Android, that way you can actually test your own hearing. And this app can be used at the community level. Before we go to the rest of the panel, I would like to hand the floor over to Dr. Shelley Chada. She actually, for the last few years, has been driving the work for WHO's program for ear and hearing care. And she's going to talk to you more about what is concrete and actionable in the report. Over to you, Shelley.
Thank you, Gaia. Thank you. Imagine me in a clinic in where I used to work in India before I came to WHO. And there I am sitting when a young lady walks into it. A young lady accompanied by her husband and his family, who are the ones who have brought her there. They're concerned because since this young lady got married and came to live in their house, she's not really communicating with them. She's not responding very often, and she seems not to be able to speak. So they bring her to the hospital where I work. Soon as I examine her, it is clear that she has profound hearing loss in both her ears. And to cut a long story short, this young lady was born deaf. Suhela, that's her name. Having been born deaf, and once her parents realized that their child was not going to talk and speak like other children, they were unsure of what to do and fearing the stigma which is so often associated with hearing loss, they decided to keep Suhela at home and to hide her deafness from the world. When she came of age, they arranged for Suhela to marry into a nice, respectable family, who are the ones who finally brought her to the hospital. What affected me, and even at that time, I would say angered me a bit about Suhela's life story, was the thought of those 18 years. 18 years spent in relative isolation, deprived of education, deprived of social interactions, deprived of friendships, which is what hearing loss does. It cuts us off from people, in Helen Keller's words. And that, ladies and gentlemen, is the real impact of unaddressed hearing loss. But this impact can be mitigated through hearing care for all, which is the central message of the World Report on Hearing. And today I would like to give the key points of this report in three key words, or rather in three key phrases, which I would like you to take away from here today. We have to. We can. We must. Let me justify these three phrases. We have to, because as the DG so eloquently put, the number of people living with hearing loss is increasing each year, and by 2050, we can expect to have 2.5 billion people with hearing loss across the world. And a third of them will need hearing rehabilitation services. And if we don't act now, the huge cost that the DG referred to will also keep rising in the coming years. So we have to act. It is no longer a choice. Good news is we can act. It is possible to have hearing across the life course. We can act to prevent hearing loss. Through various public health strategies, we can prevent hearing loss, or at least a large portion of it. We can identify hearing loss through technological advances. It is possible to identify hearing loss from the first day of one's life till the last. It's possible to identify it in a community setting, in a clinical setting. All possibilities are open to us. We can do it. And we can address it. We have amazing, effective, and cost-effective solutions which can address the needs of anyone who lives with hearing loss. We can address it. And so we must. We must act to integrate people-centered ear and hearing care within the national health plans for universal health coverage. We must do this. And the World Report on Hearing shows us how this can be done. This can be done through integrating, through prioritizing a hearing package of interventions that the World Report elaborates upon. And this package must be delivered through the health systems, which are empowered to provide these services through various actions, through various strategic actions which are taken within the health systems to address its shortcomings. So we can deliver this through a strengthened health system. And taking such action and scaling up ear and hearing care, as the DG showed, over a 10-year period will cost less than $1.4 per person per year, avoiding over 130 million disability-adjusted life years in this period, benefiting 1.4 billion people, and bringing a return of $16 for every dollar we invest. That, ladies and gentlemen, is the promise of ear and hearing care. And so we must act. We must act to achieve the 2030 target of a 20% increase in the effective coverage of ear and hearing care services. So to summarize, once again, the three key words, we must integrate ear and hearing care, people-centered ear and hearing care, within national health plans. Because we have to integrate. Inaction is no longer a choice. The cost of doing nothing is one we cannot afford anymore. And because we can do it. We can do it, and the World Report on Hearing shows us how to do it. So we have to act to make hearing care for all a reality. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Shelley. Thank you. Next, I'd really like to hear from people who have experienced this firsthand. When I read about the next speaker, Alana Nichols, I was extremely inspired. She was born with an extremely rare form of deafness. She was lucky enough to undergo experimental surgery and rehabilitation, but she was also strong and brave enough not to let her circumstances define her. Today, Elena is a television show host, She has won numerous television and film awards. She is absolutely an inspiration. And she works very hard to create visibility for people with hearing loss and to challenge the misconceptions and the myths that Dr. Tedros talked about earlier. So it's my pleasure to invite Elena to share her experience with us on this very important day.
Thank you for the kind introduction, Dr. Gaya, and I'd really like to thank WHO for inviting me to speak today about the potential of EON hearing care. This topic is deeply important to me because I am someone who almost did not receive EON hearing care. I was born with a common cavity malformation, which resulted in profound hearing loss. At the time, my parents were strongly encouraged by others to keep me at home. The culture at the time believed that if you were a family with a child who had hearing loss, you kept them at home and you cared for them for life. Big part of my success today is because my parents fought extremely hard for me to have access to the resources that I needed, as well as the rehabilitation. It was extremely important for me to emphasize and share my story because my parents not only had to fight this culture that tried to suppress their needs, but they also needed to bring a surgeon who would agree to perform the experimental surgery on me. The reason I say this is because every surgeon that they took me to refused to perform the surgery once they saw the complexity of my case and the malformations in my x-rays. Fortunately, they found a surgeon who agreed to perform the experimental surgery in Australia, and it was an unexpected success. Shortly after, I began intense verbal therapy, and that continued all throughout my childhood. However, there were many challenges along the way, and it was not always easy. Something that my parents often reminded me of over and over again when I was frustrated by my communication difficulties and challenges was that it is not always a quick fix. And I think this is a really critical point, really important point to emphasize in ear and hearing care. The way it was explained to me is it's not like putting on glasses and you hear the world clearly. So it was more like a muscle that you train and you maintain all throughout your life. And that was especially true for me to maintain my ear health, my hearing, and my speech. And this is a really important point that I want to emphasize and that Shelley so powerfully articulated in her speech and her PowerPoint, is that it's absolutely essential to have access to ear and hearing care because as a television host, producer, and speaker, I've been fortunate to work with deaf schools in Africa and Asia. As a speaker, I've presented in Europe, Australia, and America. In all of these places, I have seen firsthand the effects of not having access to the necessary ear and hearing care and rehabilitation. I have seen children and grandparents ostracized and isolated because of this. And it's time that we change the conversation around it. Because EON hearing care is not only about that, it's actually also about language and communication access. Research shows time and time again that access to communication is critical to connection with others, is critical to a sense of belonging and happiness, and very importantly, it is extremely important in giving people the ability to advocate for themselves in this world. Although every hearing, hard of hearing, and deaf person has unique needs, it is likely that most people will need access to hearing care, ear and hearing care at some point in their lives. And this is why this field is extremely critical. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Elena. Dr. Tedros already introduced our next speaker, the Honourable Minister from India. Many countries have already started working in this area, but Minister, I know this is an area very close to your heart. You are an otolaryngologist. You have already initiated work. You've taken leadership. I'm sure everybody will be very, very curious to hear how you've been able to fast track this area of work in your country. Over to you, Minister.
My dear friend and colleague, Director General of the World Health Organization, Dr. Tedros, all colleagues from the WHO, and other dear friends, I'm extremely pleased to be a part of today's launch of this long-awaited world report on hearing. Being an ENT specialist myself, who has worked in the clinical and public health fields for more than four decades, I've been a witness from very close quarters to the devastating impact of unaddressed issues of hearing loss on people, their families and communities, and therefore on society at large. Having spent a good four decades in the field of ENT and keenly watching the developments, I completely understand that although hearing loss is often referred to as the invisible disability, but its impact on a person's life is profound. Despite evidence of the impact of hearing loss on academic and scholastic performance in the young, of cognitive decline and dementia in the elderly, and also clear evidence of its economic and social impact, it unfortunately enjoys little awareness and emphasis among administrators and governments. Even in our ancient scriptures, such as the Vedas, there is mention of the importance of hearing. Shrunu yam shraddha shatam. May God, we hear up to 100 years. This is exactly why today's report, which is being launched, is critical and timely. The smallest of ear problems, for instance, take the example of ear infections, not only lower the quality of life of a human being, but at times even threaten their lives due to dangerous complications arising out of them. We know very well that such ear conditions and their associated hearing loss is both preventable and treatable. Yet, over 2% of my own country, India's population, mainly children, suffer from otitis media. In fact, so prevalent is the condition that some people believe that it is normal and natural for children's ears to discharge. At the same time, we also face hearing loss due to high decibel noise pollution at workplaces and on the roads, as well as due to the use of ototoxic medicines and chemicals. We are also aware that a large percentage of youth population, combined with over 750 million smartphone users in the country, has also exposed us to the danger of loud music and unsafe listening, leading to impaired hearing health. India has recently concluded the world's largest study to date on hearing loss and its causes in our population. A multi-centric cross-sectional survey conducted as per the WHO recommended PPS, probability proportional to size, sampling technique, assessed 92,097 people in the community across six sites in India. Age-appropriate audiological testing as per WHO norms, including pure tone audiometry, tympanometry, otoacoustic emissions, behavioral observation audiometry, and ENT examination were all undertaken on site in a specially designed sound-treated audiological bus. The results of this study show a changing profile of hearing loss in our population and may represent similar changes in other countries as they move forward in economic development. The prevalence of total hearing loss, unilateral and bilateral, is noted to be as high as 9.93%. The study showed that the disabling hearing loss affected 2.9% of the population and was noted to affect communication, education, and work. The rural population had a far greater prevalence of hearing loss. The four commonest etiologies were presbycusis, 3.46% population prevalence, infectious ear diseases / chronic suppurative otitis media, CSOM, 2.80% population prevalence, early onset presbycusis, 1.01% population prevalence, and impacted VACs, 0.55% population prevalence. In contrast to our previous experience, only one-third of hearing impairment currently is noted as purely conductive and reversible. The geriatric population accounted for 40.5% of all hearing loss and 72.4% of all disabling hearing loss. As our population ages, it is obvious that this proportion of age-related hearing loss is going to increase and will undoubtedly contribute to their social isolation and possibly cognitive decline. This study has also made a major contribution by identifying the risk factors associated with sensory neural hearing loss. Smokeless tobacco consumption, heavy smoking, leisure and work-related noise, and also excessive residential noise are all noted as risk factors associated with sensory neural hearing loss. The insight we have gained on risk factors will enable us to put in place preventive strategies so as to limit the impending mountain of hearing loss as our population ages. To address these needs, in 2006, India launched the National Program for Prevention and Control of Deafness. Much before this program was launched at the national level, during the 1990s, when I was Health Minister of Delhi State, the capital of India, we launched a novel public campaign called the Shravan Shakti Abhiyan, which was basically a community movement for developing solutions to the problems being faced by general public to prevent and control hearing loss and deafness. These movements created a lot of awareness amongst public for the urgent need to go in for early intervention to prevent complete deafness. Over 6% of our population has disabling hearing loss and require interventions. Through the implementation of this program, the Government of India is working towards a society where people with hearing loss are able to live fulfilling lives. This program focuses on preventing hearing loss, especially that which is caused by ear infections and noise, and early identification of deaf babies and hard of hearing persons. The program also envisages timely provision of suitable interventions and services like medicines, surgery, hearing devices, and rehabilitation. Last year, that is during 2019-20, more than 30,000 free of cost ENT surgeries and around 24,000 hearing aids were provided under this program. Though we have made a modest start, we know that we are moving in the right direction. With an annual implementation budget of 35 crores, which is approximately $5 million, funded fully by the Government of India, the National Program for Prevention and Control of Deafness now covers 595 districts in the country, reaching nearly 80% of the country's population. In the coming years, based on the recommendations of this report, we plan to further strengthen our work on hearing health and care. We plan to improve services at the community and primary levels through training of health workers for task sharing in line with the strategies outlined in the report. We also plan to expand access to affordable hearing technologies for all those in need. Another premium objective is to use the power of information technology to raise awareness among our youth on safe listening as a means of hearing loss prevention. As part of Make in India Drive and moving towards a self-reliant India, we are now producing the highest quality and reasonably priced digital hearing aids. An indigenous cochlear implant is being developed. We are providing teleotology and teleaudiology services, which have been able to screen close to 1 million people across the country with its breakthrough indigenous technology. We are also now training among the largest number of audiology personnel globally. Through our efforts, we hope to create a society where every Indian, including those with hearing loss, is able to gain education, learn, seek employment, earn and lead a productive life, thereby setting an example for the rest of the world. We are also prepared to lead this work on the global stage. On behalf of my country, I express my commitment to making hearing care for all a reality and offer the considerable technical skills, experiences, and expertise of India to the rest of the world. I thank you for this invitation and look forward to a stronger action for ear and hearing care within and beyond India's borders. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Minister. Thank you. What a story you told, from the use of science, data, understanding risk factors, to the policy, to the services, to the action from community, all the way to the national level and beyond to help other countries. Minister, while you're here, I thought I would raise a point that during COVID, many people were struggling to access proper, safe information about the COVID-19 pandemic. And WHO's Health Emergency Program, where I work, we managed to work with the deaf community in India to develop the first ever COVID-19 training in sign language. And I know some of those people are on this call, so I wanted to appreciate people from your country, people from the community itself, who took action, who reached out to us and collaborated with us to develop COVID-19 courses free of charge in Indian Sign Language. And I understand that Mongolia and other countries are following suit. Next, I really wanted to pick up the point of what Dr. Shelley said. And by the way, all panelists, please read the chat. people are really inspired by your stories and your experiences. So Dr. Shelley talked about Suhela, this person who hid her secret for 18 years. I would like really to focus in with the next speaker a little bit about that experience, about coming to terms with hearing loss, particularly if it's over a period of time. And to do this is a renowned author, Catherine Bouton. She will tell you her story, I hope, about this progressive loss. She's absolutely an activist. She's a former journalist, and now she's a author of several books on the topic. So Catherine, it's my pleasure to welcome you and ask you to share with us your particular experience.
Thank you very much for inviting me to talk about my hearing loss, which is very different from Alana's and Sedilia's and the members of this wonderful youth choir. I was born a hearing person, and I heard well into adulthood. I was 30 when overnight I suddenly lost all the hearing in one of my ears. I had no family history of hearing loss, and I was quite healthy. I woke up one morning profoundly deaf in my left ear. So I went to a doctor who did a lot of tests and found no explanation for my loss. My right ear still worked. So I ignored the loss. I didn't get hearing aids. I never learned sign language. Over the next 20 years, the loss became bilateral and more severe. And I had to acknowledge it to myself anyway. Telling other people would come a lot later. I finally did get hearing aids when I was 52, which was 22 years after that first diagnosis. They worked well enough for a while, for about 8 years. And then when they no longer helped, I got a cochlear implant in my worst ear. That was in 2009. And I have a stronger hearing aid. I still wear a hearing aid in my better ear. So why did it take me so long to get hearing aids? Why did it take me even longer to acknowledge the loss and ask for accommodations that would have helped me? I am not at all alone in this delay. It takes people an average of 6 or 7 years from the time of diagnosis to treatment. The answer is stigma. Stigma ranges from deep-seated fear and misunderstanding of deafness to the association of deafness with aging and cognitive decline. The stigma of deafness has a very long history. It dates back to pre-Christian Hebrew law, which prohibited the deaf from participating in the rituals of the temple. That was in 1000 BC. Aristotle in ancient Greece declared the deaf incapable of reason and thus ineligible for citizenship in Athens. Jesus cast out the deaf and dumb spirit that possessed a child. And until quite recently, some fundamentalist Christians, especially in the United States, cited that passage associating deafness with possession by the devil. Superstitions are still powerful in many societies, and the stigma of hearing loss is pervasive, and it is hugely damaging. Hearing loss is universally dismissed as a condition of aging. Adult onset hearing loss is. Millions of people simply retreat into isolation rather than take steps that would allow them to continue to be active members of society. That isolation leads to depression. Depression contributes to dementia, and a life is lost because of the stigma of seeming old and useless. Acknowledging hearing loss is not easy. Coming to terms with deafness can take a really long time. Hearing health professionals need to understand that, and they need to help their patients understand it. And all of us need to understand that although hearing aids work very well for many people, they are not enough for people with severe loss. We need additional devices, assistive devices, and we need accommodations, which I'm not going to talk about today, but is a whole subject on its own. Cochlear implants are miracles, but they are not a magic bullet. It takes dedicated hard work to learn to hear again with a cochlear implant. Despite my hearing aid and my cochlear implant and the best technologies available, I still couldn't hear. I lost my job, a job I loved. I couldn't function professionally. But stigma was at work here too. My employer would have found another job for me. That was, my employer was the New York Times. I was a journalist. They would have found another job for me, one that didn't require hearing well, and that would have provided accommodations as well, like a captioned phone and others. But I was too proud to acknowledge my loss. I was too ashamed to accept a job that would have been an acknowledgement of my disability. So I quit. I walked out, and that's when grief hit me. Grief is a totally appropriate response to losing your hearing. I grieved not just the loss of one of my senses, but the loss of my work, the loss of myself, the loss of my identity. I retreated into isolation and depression, and it was combined with anger and continuing denial. I was not a pleasant person to be around. I was lucky. I found a support group almost by chance. The Hearing Loss Association of America, going through what I had. We shared stories and we shared strategies. We supported each other. We found a safe space together for our hearing loss. I went on to write a book about my experience and to become an advocate for people with hearing loss. I found new friends, new profession, a new life. I defied the stigma. And now I try to help others do the same. Hearing loss is preventable and it is treatable. That's what this report is saying. Once we begin to treat it, with hearing aids, yes, for those with severe loss, but for the far more numerous cases of mild to moderate loss with direct consumer hearing devices. Because once we treat it, hearing loss, stigma will begin to fade away. Everyone wears things in their ears these days. Apple sold 60 million AirPods in 2019. The newer AirPods, AirPods Pro, include many of the same features as hearing aids, and they cost a fraction of the cost of hearing aids. Other less expensive hearing devices look just like fancy Bluetooth mics or expensive earbuds. Once people are wearing them, young people as well as old, I think stigma will disappear. It won't be easy, but acknowledging the toll hearing loss takes on individuals and societies, as this report is doing, is a really good start. Then governments and health ministries need to invest in prevention, education, and better technology. And I think that we can make hearing loss a thing of the past. And I'm very happy to WHO for their part in making this happen. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Catherine. Thank you. We've heard from a range of things, from the global evidence to policy, but also really to the human experience in this and how each experience, while unique, is part of this really compelling story and compels us towards the actions that Dr. Shelley talked about. So people have been writing in questions in the Q&A, and I thought I would just take a few minutes to very quickly go back to our panel and ask a few questions. So let me just go back to Alana. Alana, how can people with hearing loss contribute themselves to making hearing care for all a reality? You've already talked about it, but what concretely can people with hearing loss do? If you unmute me, Alana. Great, thank you. I'm not able to hear you. Are people in the?
I'm sorry, are you able to hear me?
Now, yes.
Well, you got a taste of what it's like to have hearing loss. I think one of the biggest things that we have to do is exactly what we're doing today, which is talking about it, sharing stories like these. And a big part of the work that I'm doing today is really trying to build representation and visibility so that hearing loss is not a unique fearful, almost fate to have. It's simply something that people have, and these are their unique needs. And how do we give people who need these communication resources, rehabilitation, all these things, how do we get access for them, really? So it's about having a conversation, it's about representation, it's about bringing it to light, really, because as I've shared, and as Catherine mentioned in her story, there's a lot of shame, there's a lot of stigma, and those things really play a role in people, whether they themselves don't get access or through their culture don't get this access. So it's really what we're doing today.
Thank you so much. And Catherine, you already talked about this, and you've done extraordinary things to, you know, shed light on this. What can you tell to the audience? We've got nearly 500 people participating. What else can people with hearing loss do to contribute to making hearing care for all, for everyone, a reality?
I agree with Alana. Basically, we have to talk about it. I don't have as big a platform as she has, but I do try through my writing and through my teaching, and that it is something that we can treat. Mild to moderate hearing loss, which is what by far the majority of people have, is very easy to treat. It responds really well to hearing aids. The problem is that we don't identify it. I can only speak for my country, but in our country, only 30% of primary care physicians will ask at an annual physical if someone is having any trouble with their hearing. It's just a simple sentence. It's a hearing screening. Even geriatricians don't ask that question at about the same rate. Only about 30% think to ask about hearing. And we know that hearing is essential for healthy aging. And I think we need to make sure that the medical community that works with adults and older people understands this and that they ask, because a person may not know to mention it themselves, because often it comes on gradually and it's hard to recognize. So, but a simple screening can evoke an awareness of that. So it's very important.
Thank you so much. I know Gaia? I really want to keep this webinar to time, but there are some questions, Shelley, about, you know, you mentioned global targets for hearing care, but how will you be able to measure the progress on this?
And Dr. Gaia, Dr. Tedros also have a question. So please put him on the list. Thank you.
Absolutely.
Thank you, Gaia, for that question. So the global target, which was mentioned by the DG, of a 20% scale up of the effective coverage of ear and hearing care services by 2030, we intend to monitor this with the help of three tracer indicators relating to different stages of the life course. So one indicator relating to newborn screening services, another relating to the prevalence of hearing loss and ear diseases, unaddressed hearing loss in school-going age children.
He speaks?
And the third indicator relates to And the third indicator relates to adult and hearing loss in adults. So those are the three indicators that we intend to monitor over the next 10 years in order to chart our progress towards this goal. Mm-hmm. So thank you, Gaia.
Thank you so much. And Shelley, people are asking how they can get the report. I'm sure it'll be on the website. Is that correct?
It is already on the website. I'll ask my colleagues to post a link to it on the chat now.
Thanks. You so much. People are very curious. So Dr. Tedros, the floor is yours.
Thank you. Thank you so much. It was amazing to listen to all our speakers. I have just one question to all of you, to Sandile, Alana, and Catherine. And of course, Minister Harshvardhan too, if you advise me one thing that WHO should do, what would that be? that we should do in relation to hearing loss? One advice, any crazy idea you have. Thank you.
Go ahead. This is the challenge to the panel. One thing.
Dr. Tedros, I think you have already followed the advice of the whole world, because the very fact that you have brought this issue to the center stage of WHO's working and on World Hearing Day, it has, I think you are releasing this report today and bringing all these stalwarts and heroes, I would call them heroes, whom I can see on the screen, because they have performed better than many of us in spite of their issues and problems. And they are the living examples for the rest of the world. And I think for a great person like you, who has so much of tremendous knowledge, who has been handling WHO and all the affairs of health for quite some time, I can't tell you one thing, but you have already done your job. Now it is only what those threes were mentioned by Dr. Shelley. I think we have to implement them, and continuous focus on these subjects, continuous monitoring of these subjects. And when you advise all the member states and in the World Health Assembly also, and at the executive board meetings in future, there has to be a monitoring of this issue. The countries have to be advised to develop their programs and report to WHO regularly on yearly basis, and they should report their positive experiences and the outcomes of the implementation of the program for giving this hearing for all. I think that's something you have already done it, and we have to take it forward. And I promise on behalf of India that we at the grassroots level, there is so much that is happening in India. Last week itself, I was in two states of India, Nagaland and Manipur. They are the northeasternmost part of India. And in Nagaland itself, the northeasternmost part of the northeastern India, I went to a health and wellness center, and you will be happy to learn that because of the guidelines that we have given to the people there at the health and wellness center, they are going from house to house in their community and trying to screen people for the non-communicable diseases, including for hearing losses. So this is very much doable, and it is only a question of ensuring that this particular issue of hearing does not get lost in hundreds of things that we have in the health sector to do. So I know you know your job, and you have already started doing it today.
Thank you so much, Minister. Catherine, what is your answer to Dr. Tedros's challenge? One thing that WHO should do.
Well, somebody asked about, let me back up. Okay, the one thing the WHO should do. Somebody asked about making all hearing healthcare free. I'm not sure that that is the answer, because we can see from the United Kingdom and Canada, where hearing care is free, that the use of hearing devices is still very small. So I think, I guess I really think that we have to basically approach a way, attack the idea of stigma. We have to figure out how we can tell people that if you have hearing loss, if you're 30 years old, 40 years, 50 years old even, and you have hearing loss, it is not a natural sign of aging. There's something actually going wrong, and it's something that's very correctable. So I think we really need to emphasize how correctable hearing loss is, and what a difference it makes in an individual's life. How to do that, I'm not quite sure. I think I have to leave that to the experts.
It's okay to raise issues and raise questions, and we can work out solutions together. Before I give it back to Dr. Tedros, we want to hear from Alana next. One thing.
I'm sorry, are you talking to me? Alana. Alana. This captains are slow.
I'm very sorry. Alana, what is the one thing that you want WHO to do?
By the way, I want to point out this is exactly what happened when you put me and my deaf friends together. We don't know who's talking to who, but I agree with Catherine that this is a multi-layered problem and it's going to require an attack from several different angles. And the angle that I would offer from my personal experience is, again, being bold in the face of this stigma. So, for example, a quick example I can think of is being a child and being encouraged to hide my cochlear implant with my hair. Or I remember grandparents being asked to hide their hearing aids with a hat, with a scarf on. And that's why on my show, at events and interviews, I wear a bright white cochlear implant because people need to see that. And that's kind of a catalyst, like, again, going back to what we mentioned earlier, talking about it, bringing it to light is kind of a catalyst for bringing attention to what is needed, essentially, because when you talk about it, you have a discussion about all everyone's unique needs in this case. And really, it's really critical to recognize that all people who are deaf and hard of hearing have unique needs. And that's why we need a multi-layered response to it. If that makes sense.
Thank you, Alana. And just for the secretariat, people are giving ideas in the chat as well. Sandile, it's your turn.
Okay, thank you. As a young person and as an artist or a performer, I think WHO should get more young people or more artists. As we can see now, everything is done using technology and young people have their favorite artists. Even old people have their favorite artists. They should get them involved in this and sending out messages and informing and teaching people about the safeties of taking care of your ears and all that, using young people and using artists. And also, musicians can also start performing using sign languages to show the importance of taking care of your ears and how difficult it is when you lose your hearing. That's what I think we should do, WHO should do.
Thank you, Sandile. Dr. Tedros, so what are your reflections after listening to all of these responses?
My response, again, my respect. I was listening to all of them, and Sandile, Alana, and Catherine, you're amazing speakers. I really enjoyed listening to you, you know, sitting and really understanding what exactly you're trying to say, and it's heartwarming, actually. Thank you so much. And this is your story. You're not saying anything abstract or anything from textbook. This is your own story, and that makes it even compelling. So thank you so much. I really learned a lot. And from Alana and Catherine, you really focused on the central issue, the stigma. And you're right. I think if we address that, as you said, multi-layered, many of the problems can be addressed. So thank you for that advice. And also, we can use, as Sandile said, youth groups and others to play their part. It should be everybody's business. When you do that, by the way, the stigma also could be addressed. And we should have a movement to increase awareness, to make it everybody's business, so the society understands. And starting from the family, by the way, the stigma starts even from the family. So starting from there, we need to address it. One proposal I have is next year would be good if we can have this meeting actually in person, and you have a standing invitation from me to all panelists today, so we can have a program next year, same day together. But between now and then, based on your advice, I can also see in the chat room many recommendations coming, you know, that we need to do. So we should start doing everything we can based on the report and the advices you have given us, and then we can meet in 1 year from now in person to again, you know, work together. So, you know, see you next year in person, but at the same time, look forward to working with you closely between now and then, and until we meet again. But this is our priority, and I can see we have really excellent partners, and we will grow that partnership, and sure we will make progress together. And to Minister Vardahan, I can see your commitment. I'm really proud. You're a leader on this, and that's why we invited India. All your achievements, especially your focus in grassroots, and there is a lot that we can learn from India, and sharing experiences of countries will be very, very important. Instead of other countries reinventing the wheel, they can learn from each other to move faster. So we will document your model, and then other models too, so we can speed up the you know, the our fight against all the challenges we're facing in terms of improving hearing loss. So thank you so much again. I'm really fortunate to be part of this, and I really learned a lot again. So thank you, Sendile, thank you, Alana, Catherine, and Minister Harsh Vardhan, my good friend. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
And
Dr.
of course, Gaia, thank you. Thank you for moderating this.
We're not quite finished, Dr. Tedros.
And in our room, we have Shelley and Bente and Alarcos, and they have been working very hard behind the scenes. They're the ones who make me look good, so I should appreciate their hard work and commitment. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Dr. Tedros. If everybody can just stay just for a few more minutes, I have two very quick items. First is Dr. Bente Mikkelsen, Director, Department of Non-Communicable Diseases. Please, everybody stay, because after this, I have just one more thing I want us to participate in. Bente, the floor is yours.
Thank you. Good afternoon. And this has really been a very special event, and I'm so happy to be here in the room, but also to Dr. Tedros to really asking questions and showing his engagement. So we see this again as one of the events that bring home, you know, to me the importance of the work we do, and that is very important for us to know. So Tedros, Honorable Dr. Harsh Vardhan, and the Nuluvu group, Sandil, Alena, and Catherine, thank you very, very much for sharing. It has actually been a long journey. As you know, all of these things take a bit of time, and we have not walked it alone. So there is a long list of acknowledgement in the report, and please also look at that, because that's really the friends, that is really who is going to make it happen for the future. More than 200 people and organizations has contributed to the content towards it. So I thank all the authors, the reviewers, the advisors for their generosity in sharing the knowledge and time with us. And apart from India, there are many member states and partner organizations that has shared their experiences and learning in the field. And you have seen in the report, hopefully, the case studies. I think this is where the solution sits. We need to copy with pride what is working well. And I need to especially mention the United States National Institute of Deafness and Other Communication Disorders, and the Institute of Health Metrics and Evaluation, who have been our companions from the start. The World Hearing Forum and its members have extended their united support in these efforts, and we remain most grateful and look for the future also with the Hearing Forum. And of course, the 24-hour Hearathon is currently underway with over 200 launch activities in more than 60 countries. So please stay tuned on Facebook, on all the social media, and you will see this happening, and in as well in the natural languages. All of this has been possible with the generous contributions, so I thank you all. And finally, I would like to thank those who are online viewing the website, and also, of course, the member states is now aware that it's now the real work starts, and we look forward to really pick all the ideas coming out of this event. And on behalf of my team, I want to reassure you that we will not be resting following this launch. It's now the work begins. So thank you very much, and we look forward. Thanks again.
Thank you so much, Bente. Thank you, everybody. Before we go, today is a very special day. We have a double celebration because it happens to be the birthday of Dr. Tedros. And Dr. Tedros, there's a gift from Sandile and his friends. So please, control room, let's share the gift.
Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, Dr. Tedros. Happy birthday to you.
Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, Dr. Tedros. Happy birthday to you.
My daughter too.
So thank you all very, very much, Dr. Tedros.
Thank you. Thank you, Sandile. I actually share my birthday with my daughter. So that makes it even very special. She's 14 today. So I will take it for me and for her. So thank you so much indeed. That was wonderful. Yeah.
Thank you, everybody. Thank you so much, everybody who joined, all different time zones. Thank you, everybody, for inviting me to. What a pleasure. I hope, as Dr. Bente said, the work begins in earnest now. Thank you all. Share your stories. Do your part. Stay engaged. And definitely, as Dr. Tedros says, we will meet next year, but with progress. Thank you, and have a wonderful day. Goodbye, everybody.
Goodbye. Thank you. Thank you very much. All the best. Thank you.